Good morning to all of you, and good morning to Purushottam sir. Hello sir, and good morning Venkat Narayan garu, and all the team of this FDP program and organizing committee. And also I also thank the management of Srinidhi Institute of Science and Technology for inviting me for the first session to share my knowledge on 3D printing water again over the past 10 years. What are the little bit knowledge I gained over the past 10 years to share the live case studies we have done in 3D printing, so that I am now concentrating on applications of 3D printing in biomedical applications, complete biomedical application. My next 1.5 hour session will be biomedical applications. So why 3D printing became very popular. As said by Dr. Purushottam, Professor Purushottam sir, that this is the emerging area of mechanical engineering where lot of research is happening and lot of scope for your getting jobs is there. And as you know, it is the recognized thrust area by Department of Science and Technology, by AICT. I hope we recently AICT has been conducting number of Atal AICT program on 3D printing and design. And in that 3D printing is a thrust area where they recognized, and also the government of India also recognized the thrust area, not only in India but overall the entire world. It is part of Industry 4.0. In Industry 4.0, you might have heard, it is the next evolution of industrial evolution. So where you have 3D printing, augmented reality, and virtual reality simulation, all these things comes under the components of Industry 4.0. So as such, 3D printing occupies a very important role, and it is changing the entire manufacturing process cycle. And I hope shortly we'll see that the CNC machines and some of those old machines getting disappearing. Most of them you will be seeing a 3D printing technology evolving, and it is getting applied in various fields. It's not only biomedical, it is popular in biomedical aerospace. It is also used in automobile industry. It is now used in jewelry industry. It is used in entertainment like film making industry. It is used in sports industry. It is used in whatever the field you think about, whatever the creativity you have. So in that field you can apply. So you have a creative thinking, there is 3D printing to help you to convert that creative idea to some physical form. So that's how 3D printing became very popular. Even now interior decorators in a home, they are using this. And people who wanted to start up also, it's a very good area where you can do startup business. Was some of my students are already there doing the startup company. They are running in 3D printing. So like this, 3D printing became very popular. And I would like to present, I hope Srinidhi Institute of Science and Technology is very vibrant in conducting such type of events. I think during lockdown, in the June itself, you have conducted a webinar series on different things. I remember Professor Purushottam sir inviting me to deliver a lecture on 3D printing in the month of June itself, June or July, I think. So I hope you are continuing the tradition. I congratulate the entire team of Srinidhi Institute of Science and Technology, especially the Mechanical Engineering Department, led by the Principal Shivareddy Garu and Purushottam and Professor Purushottam sir, and the young faculty like Venkat Narayana Garu, everyone. And because this type of activities will definitely bring a lot of encouragement for the faculty to develop and also to deliver the same content to the students also, right? So with this introduction, I would like to start my lecture. I would like to share my screen. Sir, is my screen visible, sir?
No, sir.
It's not visible?
Not, sir.
Yes, sir. Visible, sir.
Visible, sir.
Visible. Okay.
Your screen is visible.
Okay, right.
Now it's okay, sir.
Right. So this is what
is visible.
Yeah. This is now, this is what I want to present here. The crux of this first slide is, you see the doctor and the engineer joining hands together. This is what I want to bring here is, that's what the 3D printing brings about. That's what I find this technology very exciting. It's not that you only work in mechanical engineers only. You can work across different streams of people. I can join hands with a doctor to solve a critical case of some crucial biomedical applications. I can also join hands with a very entertaining film personality like Rajamouli or any other person, and I can create wonderful sets for him to make the next Bahubali 3 or some other very big screen, big movies. You are interested in movie making, I say 3D printing is area where you can use it in your movie making also. So you are still in the mechanical domain, but you are applying it for a different field. That is the variation, that is innovation that you can bring if you have the skill set of 3D printing. You can also work with a forensic scientist or another one, investigate a criminal case. You can also work with a sports person in developing a new type of sports gear, like you may develop safety guards for the cricket batsmen, or you can develop a zinc wicket system that you are now using in all formats of cricket. You can also develop a shoe, a Reebok shoe things you can make, and help the sprinter or the athletics to run fast. You can also work with a jewelry industry person to make very creative, innovative jewelry design. So this is what I mean to say is, this is the scope of area you can work, right? So what I am going to present today is entirely the case studies on biomedical application of 3D printing. What you are seeing on the screen is some interesting parts. So I recognized the potential of 3D printing with doctors around 2009 when we started working with our SLS 3D printer we have. And at that time, I worked with doctors. Now I have contact with around 7-8 hospitals which are taking the help of us in solving some critical cases. Recently we had a discussion with another doctor on developing artificial heart pump, etc. So we are working in these areas like that. So what you are seeing on the top left side of the screen is you can see on the skull there is a fracture on the skull here. This entire portion of the bone got fractured. This is called cranioplasty surgery. So you want to develop a implant for this one. So that means the doctor has to put an implant. See the shape of this particular implant. It is not a regular circular ellipse, etc. It is a very very difficult different shape. And how to develop such type of implant? How to model everything? So here your mechanical engineering comes to help. And you help doctor in developing such type of implant like this type of we have made not direct implant. We have made a pattern of the implant. Using the pattern of the implant, we have made a mold. From that, the biocompatible implant is manufactured. If you have a direct 3D printer, metal 3D printer, you can directly produce an implant from here. Similarly, at the left side middle, you can see a particular person, the face has, this is called zygomatic region where there's a hit and this particular bone fractures, and here the eye volume gets affected. So the vision of the person gets affected. Now how I am going to help doctor in evaluating how much is the amount of restoration happened after operation? So we are going to use 3D printing for solving such case. We are going to help in, this is called orbital volume analysis. Similarly, you are seeing a spinal cord here. So spinal injuries are now becoming common for most of the people because of the way we are living, the lifestyle we are having, the stress we are having, the travel we are spending a lot of time. This spine is getting affected. You know, spine is a very important part of a body which connects all parts of the human body, connecting the brain to all parts of the human body. And if there is any kind of degeneration, some problem happens, you will be in trouble. So to solve this case, the doctors will perform endoscopic operations to solve this. So how I am going to use 3D printing for solving such cases? How I am going to help doctors in what you call planning the surgery for that, right? And you can also see here a conjoint. These are at the bottom of the left corner. You please observe my cursor. You are seeing two twins joined with heads. They're born with this called conjoint twins. They are joined with heads, and when they are very young, it is possible to separate them. So the doctors took the help of additive manufacturing 3D printing to separate them. All right. So these are some interesting case studies I am going to present in these case studies, around 78 case studies on biomedical applications. Before I go into that, we would like to just tell about our center. Center for Product Design Development IT Manufacturing is a state of the art center established under RUSA 2.0 in our University College of Engineering, Usmania University. It is now open, and it has got various equipment like SLM, metal 3D printing already installed, SLS, selective laser sintering, SLA, stereolithography apparatus, direct light processing, PolyJet, Ultimaker SY Pro, FDM 3D printer, Arctite 3D scan. So you have a bunch of technologies here. Metal you have, you have polymer based powder bed fusion technology, you have a liquid based SLA, you have a liquid based PolyJet, you have wire based that is solid based, Ultimaker SY Pro, we have 3D, even you can do reverse engineering, we have Arctite 3D scanner, right? So we offer the internships to BE students. They can come and do their project work, use our facilities, ME, MTech project work or PhD scholars on a nominal payment basis for the material, etc. We also do consultants work with other industries like DMRL, DRDL and other companies. We also have what you call with the doctors, hospitals around Hyderabad also, we serve them for solving these cases. In fact, most of our students will do project work with the doctors around Hyderabad in solving such critical cases. This is led by our dynamic director, Professor Sriram Katesh, is the director of the center, and I am the joint director for the center, right? So just to show what is the capability matrix we have here. This is what we have, different composite, different specifications. What we have, SLM, Formiga P100, Object 30 Pro, Fab Pro 1000, Ultimaker S5 Pro, FlashForge printer, we have Arctite 3D scanner. So you can just, it is displayed in our website also. And anyone wants to use these facilities, they are welcome to use these facilities. They are allowed to use these facilities. Yeah. Now, these are the things I am going to present today, around 9 case studies. As I said, we both join hands to bridge the gap, the doctor and the engineer, because he was selected by PC, became a doctor, I have selected MPC, I became engineer. But now the time has come for both of us to join hands and solve these cases. Some of the cases which are very critical and which help those human beings to overcome those trouble. So as you see nowadays, you go to any hospital, any big hospitals or any other small hospitals also, you see a lot of these gadgets playing a very important role in arriving at a decision for the doctor. That means you are becoming an additional hand to the surgeon. Now, we all know that doctors we treat as the next to God, because he's the person who gives lives to us. But now I say, yes, doctor is a God, but engineer is a weapon in the hand of the doctor. Why it is where we are weapon in the hand of the doctor is, for any god to kill the demon, that is to kill the rakshasa or demon, etc., the god uses some kind of weapon, right? So that weapon, we are also like a weapon which kill the disease using our technology, like our CT scan, which is developed by some engineer, or MRI scan, again developed by engineer, it's a gadget. Or you take about any kind of our planning the surgery, 3D printing technology, it is used by doctor a lot nowadays. You'll be surprised to know that some of the doctors have their own 3D printers in their clinics, etc. Right? So that is the era in which we are living. So I say we become an additional hand to the surgeon in solving such critical cases. Right? So we are a weapon in the hand of the God. Without a weapon, God cannot kill the disease. And without God, a weapon cannot kill the disease. So both should join hands, then only we can kill the disease, right? That's what you can see. So why 3D printing become popular in medicine? I think, sir, there is some crosstalk happening, sir. Hello, sir. Sir, there is some crosstalk happening, sir. Hello.
Hello, sir. Purushottam, sir. Can you please mute your, sir? Hello. Yes, sir. You can continue, sir.
Now, shall I continue, sir? Is the muted?
Yes, sir. You can continue, sir. Please continue, sir.
Right. So, why 3D printing is required in medicine is, there are different ways. No, human body is not a straight line or some other thing. It is very complex in nature and curvilinear in nature. So how to make such type of complex shapes? that is very difficult to make using conventional method. But using 3D printing, you can produce it like as it is, and also with more accuracy than the conventional method. You can also get the physical feel of the area of interest, how that as broken as I shown on the skull, that fracture happened, how that has broken. If I make a model out of it, I can have a touch and feel it. That is physical feel you can get. And other important thing is, what does physical models will help? What does physical models help is, it will help in plan, prepare and practice the surgery. That is, you can communicate and educate the patient very easily with a physical model, because if you have a fracture, you take an X-ray and go to the orthopedic surgeon. The orthopedic surgeon will show this, the X-ray will show and say, this is how the fracture happened. But I don't know how many of you as a layman in a medical field, how many of you understand how the fracture happened? We just believe doctor and we take it. But if the same doctor is able to show a 3D printed model of how the fracture happened, then you will touch and feel, then you will appreciate, okay, this what is happening. This is a course of action that is going to be taken by doctor to solve this case. So that is the communication. You can educate the patient, so can improve the confidence of the patient before the operation is done. And next thing is, the doctor can diagnose, and surgical planning you can do. So you can plan your surgery. Doctor can plan his surgery well in advance before the operation is performed. And rehearsal and simulation of surgery. Before you do any complex surgery, doctor has to do a lot of planning. And if possible, he try to simulate the surgery on a mock model. If you try to simulate a surgery on a mock model, then it will be very useful for doctor when he does the operation, very useful. Especially 3D printing is very helpful in doing planned surgeries. So for example, immediately you require to perform an operation, then 3D printing takes time to make the model. But if you can reduce the time of making the model, you are ready to help the doctor in emergency also, right? But in most of the cases where complex surgeries are there, they plan it in advance. So during that planning phase, the doctor, for example, in most of the cases, the young doctors are not allowed to directly operate. They are under the guidance of a senior doctor to do it. So for this young doctor to get exposed, they are not allowed to touch the live human body immediately. But to get exposed, you can make a model of that same thing and ask this young doctor to practice on that one. So he will get confidence how to do operation, right? Rehearsal and simulation of surgery, creation of customized prosthetic. This is very important. Why it is called creation of customized prosthetics? And until now, what we are getting is, we get a implant. For example, there's a hip implant that you want to make insert to a patient. Most of these hip implants are made from titanium or stainless steel. They are imported from Western countries, European or American countries, etc. So in those companies, we'll make according to the anatomy of those Europeans or the Western Americans. You know, the anatomy of an American is different from an Indian. They are big in size, etc. And you are in an average size, and automatically the implant they designed is suits for them, but not for Indians. So most of the case, what happens when you fix those implants, what happens is, the patient will not feel comfortable because it is not exactly to his size. The average Indian size is different from the average American size or the average European size. Or for example, you think about the Eastern countries like China, etc. Their size is still smaller, so you cannot have it. But if you have a 3D printing technology, you can customize according to your country's anatomy. That means you can make an implant as per the average Indian age, so that becomes more comfortable for the patient. That's how you can do creation of customized prosthetics. Accurate placement of implant, that is another one, because when you not only putting implant, that accuracy with which you are putting implant should be correct. Otherwise, it creates a next another problem to the patient. This is where 3D printing helps a lot. What transformation you bought in 3D printing, from a 2D image to 3D model. So you are able to easily understand what is happening, and you are able to, the doctor will be appreciating what things they have to do very easily. And these are the various areas where now 3D printing is biomedical, like orthopedic implants, very famous implants are done. Human anatomy, like this, you see surgical aid instrument, even the instruments used for medical operation, etc. You can make those instruments and customize instruments, you can make and give it to the doctors. And you can also know, this is used in tissue engineering, scaffold making. That means you want to grow a implant inside the body itself naturally. Then for that cell to grow, you require some supporting structure called scaffold. So those scaffolds are in complex shapes, etc. So if you want to produce such complex shape, as you are able to see here, this type of shapes you want to produce, it's not that easy to produce using a conventional method of manufacturing. You had to go for 3D printing for making this type of shapes. And you know, people are thinking of bioprinted organs. It will still take another 10 years, but it is still in the experimental stage. You are printing a direct ear, you are printing a artificial skin or printed kidney, etc. This is going to happen in another 10 years, but it's not that easy to make it. So still people are doing a lot of research, and some small experimental thing is also done so far. But so far directly commercially, they are not, one or two rare cases they have put, but it is not still happening in large scale. But I hope in another 10 years this will also happen. And what is the advantage of this printed organs is, you need not wait for the another, for example, there is a heart transplant or the liver transplant you do. So you have to take from some other person and put into it, and there may be a rejection, etc. Your body may reject it. But in this case, you can directly make according to that person and make it. So this is another area where this is happening a lot. This work is happening a lot. So let us see how, what is the general procedure for creating a medical model. So I expecting that all of you know the process chain of 3D printing or the basic steps involved in 3D printing. I'm just putting in a different way how you can use it for medical field. So you can see here the input for us should come as a CT or MRI scan in the DICOM format. It is called digital imaging and communication medicine. So whenever you want to do a biomedical modeling, you have to ask them to take in the form of DICOM format. Once you take a DICOM format, then you can see medical image data capture you have to do. That you can use a MIMIC software or 3D doctor software you can use. And using this medical MIMIC software, you can develop a CAD model. In the CAD model, that means I will tell you how you do this detailed way I will tell. So once you take a medical imaging software, MIMIC or 3D doctor, you develop the CAD model. Then you convert into STL file, that is triangulation, you do it. Once you convert to STL file, then send it to the 3D printing machine. From there, you produce the part, and then you go for post-processing like cleaning, curing, removing, etc. Until you get the finished model. These are the basic steps involved in this any medical modeling things. I will explain in detail how you do all those things in the next slides. Well, let us see what is the role of different people in developing these biomedical models. For example, the input for us will be in the form of a patient, and you take in the form of CT image, CT scan image. You take a CT scan image, and that is you use an instrument called tomography. The persons who are working is a radiologist and a surgeon. So first you have to do data acquisition. So for data acquisition, the input is a patient. Once you get the CT image, then develop the CAD model. So you develop the 3D virtual CAD model using dedicated software like you may use MIMIX, or you may use a 3D doctor, or you may use a Invisalign, you may use a Rhino software. So like this, you different software you can use. And here the people required to work is the computer graphic expert. You are a mechanic, you know AutoCAD, CAD modeling, etc. So you are there, you work with the surgeon. So in biomedical application, at every point of time, the surgeon validation is very important, because he is the person who is authorized to do it. He is having that medical knowledge. So you have to take his approval every time. Once you develop the 3D CAD model, then you have to develop the 3D physical model. So you convert the 3D CAD model into STL file, then develop the 3D RP model. There you may use different technologies like stereolithography SLA, or you may use FDM, or you may use SLM, or any what are the technology you feel. So here the person who will be helping the doctor or giving a hand, what you call supporting hand to the surgeon, is the rapid prototyping expert or a 3D printing expert. Again, as a mechanical engineer, you are there. You are the only person who knows about 3D printing a lot. So you help doctor in making these things, right? Once you get this one, then once you get the 3D model, then you validate whether it is correct or not by the surgeon. And after validation, if for example there is some errors you require to do, again you go and edit and again make another model. So this happens, is the iterative process. Here again computer graphic expert will be there, and then a doctor will do virtual surgical planning. Once you freeze your model, then the doctor will perform virtual surgical planning on that one, on the model. Then you can go for the next step, that is relevant measures, physical simulation of surgical procedure, and finally they'll perform the operations. I hope here you can see how your role is there in performing this what you call critical operations. So you are there as developing a CAD model, you are there in developing the 3D printed model, and you are finally approving the final model with the help of the surgeon. So this is where your important what your contribution lies here, right? So this is how the doctor and engineer will start working together here. As I said in the previous slides, what are the steps involved when you want to build a 3D model? So first thing is, once you take a CT scan image, you take into a software like Mimix or Invisalign, etc. What you have to do is they will apply one thing called threshold value. So what is threshold value is nothing but is the first action performed to create a segment and mass on a set of digital images. I hope you are seeing the CT scan image, number of layers are there. They are all combined together to form a one image, one model. So here, for example, there is a fracture on the on this side. So when you take a CT scan image, in that image, along with this area, you get other portion also. So I am interested in the inside bone. The bone is a hard material and the skin is a soft material. So when you take the image, you get both soft and hard material. So my area of interest, my concentration is only on the bone. So I have to remove the soft metal. I would only develop CAD model for that particular bone one. So for that, when you take the image, you have pixels, you call it as. So the threshold of image density, relative image lightness, is set manually at a specific value or automatically set by an application. So pixels, for example, I am taking bone. The threshold value of bone is around 500 to 1000, etc. So when you select the threshold value, remaining images will get become zero because I am only selecting that brightness. So bone has got more brightness, other images will become zero automatically. It's like in a bit, you know, in a digital info you call zero is 0 1. So if it is one, it is bone. If it is zero, it is other one. So you eliminate those things, right? Pixel below the threshold values are converted to black, bit value of zero, and pixels above the threshold value are converted to white by this software, which are the software using Mimix or Rhinoceros or your Invisalign or 3D Doctor. They will do like this. So once they do it, then they segmentation density mark, that means remove unnecessary things, then they grow that region, then they develop the 3D CAD model. So let us see here. In this case, I am importing a DICOM file here into my software. It may be an Invisalign software. Then what I see when I import, as soon as on the screen, I will see three areas like axial, sagittal, coronal. This is called a biomedical application. If you compare with our engineering, it's like a, what you call, let us see here at the bottom, you are able to see the sagittal is nothing but the side view. Sagittal is nothing but the side view. The coronal is the front view. The coronal is the front view. And the axial is the top view. See the top view. So what I finally understand is, we engineers, we are calling front view, top view, side view. The doctors are calling axial, sagittal, coronal. Both are meanings almost same. So the science behind both the engineering and medicine, I feel it's almost same. We are using, they are using our engineering knowledge to their application biomedical. They are also, we are also using their knowledge in a different way, right? So once you get these three views on your screen, then you select the threshold value. You will be any software, you have this one. Threshold value is 226 to 307. One side threshold, you can see this bright green color, they are bone. So generally bone will be having brightness higher than the other structures, right? So other parts of the human body. So once I do it, this is what the threshold value I've selected. Then I'll crop. This is the area where I am concentrating on my region of interest is this one. Once I crop this, then I'll get this object out. From that image, I'll get this portion, right? This is what you have to do in a biomedical model, in biomedical application. As you know that in 3D printing, CAD modeling plays very important role. So if the CAD model developed is not correct, the final end product will be a failure. So it's like garbage in, garbage out. Here also, when you do biomedical modeling, this is the important phase in doing biomedical modeling. If you don't do correctly this step, then the entire implant or what are the things you're developing will be a failure. So please be more attentive and select the correct thing and do this process. So as you know, selected, then once I said do it, then I export into STL data. So these are the regular, as per the medical journal, these are the threshold values given for different parts of the human body, like bone tissue, 1000, liver, 40 to 60, white matter encephalon 46, gray matter for blood 40. So based on your region of interest, your area of whether it you are taking a soft tissue or a hard tissue or a liver or a kidney, you have to select those threshold values. Commonly used biocompatible materials are stainless steel, titanium, polymethyl methacrylate, polyether, ether ketone, calcium hydroxyapatite, acryl nitrile, butadiene, styrene, M30I, etc. Right. So let us see how with this basic fundamentals I have given to you how I can do biomedical. Let me present to you how I do for this case study one on orbital volume analysis in mid-facial fractures using 3D print technology. This is a part of my UGC minor project work done with the collaboration of SVS Medical College. Dr. Abhinandan was with us. So what is that zygote mid-facial fractures? You see, whenever there is such type of accidents happen, roids or little boxing ring, they hit and you see, this is a very delicate bone, it hits and your eye gets displaced or some car accident, etc. This will happen. And the problem here is the patient vision gets affected. So you have to perform an operation such that his vision restores to almost nearer to the original one, right? So it's not 100% you can reach, but at least you'll reach 90%, 91%, 92%, etc. So our idea here is to tell doctor how he can improve the operating procedure, for which we want to tell doctor how much is the restoration happened before operation, after operation, right? So this is what I am just telling the zygomatic frontal sutures, etc. So some of you might get bored, start using a lot of biomedical terms, but now you have to use because we are working with the doctors, we learn a lot of them. So you should be, when you do a interdisciplinary work, you should have that knowledge also of learning the other things, right? So appetite to learn new things should be there, as a researcher, you should be there. Right. So these are the different areas of the front portion. So just I want to highlight the terminology. Maxilla, this is called orbit. This is where I am concentrating fracture lines, etc. So whenever we do such kind of operations, human body, they are called landmark points. They are called. So any doctor now will they have that knowledge? Medical when they learn their MBS, etc. They have these landmark points. For example, our area of interest is this orbital volume dye. So here what happens is you will select some landmark points. You are able to see this portion of this, this portion of this is called contralateral side, where there is no fracture happened here. So, I'll measure the distance between these landmark points, supraorbital foramen, infraorbital foramen. This is called zygomatal suture. This is called medial orbit. So I'll measure these distances. Once I measure the distances, then I will know from this how much is the volume of the contralateral side, that is without fracture, normal eye. I know for that person what is this volume normal eye. But now you can see the left side. As you see from your side, this is left for you. This side, actually for the person, it is the right side. Right. So you see how the fracture happened here. The bone has fractured. Here you see how the bone is there. It has fractured like this. So doctor has to know, join all the bone pieces and perform the operation. Now, again, I will measure the same landmark points. These landmark points are given by the doctor. I will measure this volume also. Once I measure this volume, then I will know how much is the amount. Because definitely before fracture, this is the volume. After fracture, the volume will increase because you can see how much is the deviation happened, the dislocation of the bone happened here. So naturally, the volume will increase. So after operation, that is after he joined all these bones, etc., then what happens is again you measure this distance between these landmark points and estimate the volume. So then you will know how much is the restoration happened. That is our work we have to do now. So for this we have done 5 to 6 case studies. So for this we considered a 20-year-old male patient. Is like this. This is how his injury happened to his eye, left lateral, frontal, and the right lateral view. And this is the methodology adopted. We have taken CT scan image in the DICOM format and we modeled it using Invascular software. Then we have produced the 3D CAD model in FDM, the physical model using FDM 3D print technology. We also used another software called a medical software, Strata 1 software, used it for measuring, for building the CAD model of the same 3D one. So we want to compare how the 3D printed model is different from the CAD model, or how much accuracy, which one is giving better accuracy, whether the 3D printed model or the CAD model. So then we analyze those results. So what we have done is we have taken the DICOM images from the hospital. Then these are the various software we have used in this work, like Radium DICOM Viewer, Invisalus 3, Blender, Autodesk Mesh Mixer, FlashPrint, and Stata1 Maxilla. This is what I was telling, Stata1 Maxilla software. So in Radiant DICOM Viewer, I can directly get how this image comes and how directly I can just to see whether the CT scan image taken is correct or not. We can see here like this. Then we use Invisalus software to, these are all, what I shown here is except this Stata1 Maxilla, all these softwares are free open source softwares. You can do, you can download and use it for any n number of times. Invisalus 3 is also affordable software. That is, it is free of cost. But now Mimics is very popular in this biomedical, but Mimics is very costly software. It has got excellent features than Invisalus, but Invisalus is a free software. That is the what you call interesting point. So you can, as you want to do this, you can start with Invisalus. The procedure is more or less same, right? So now what I have taken is step one, I have taken the CT scan images in DICOM file, I imported into it. Then step two, after importing, you see, as I said, three views you get, axial, sagittal, and coronal, like side view, top view, and front view. So once I get this, then I selected the threshold value. So I selected the minimum as 226, maximum 303071. So I got the shape. I got the shape here, right? Are you able to see, right? So this is a 3D model I got here from here. So export this 3D surface and save it as .html format. I export it. Then next, when I do know, so there are some kind of errors coming up. What are those? You have to clean those errors. This is called unwanted regions or discontinuous regions. So you, there I use a software called Blender. It is again open free source software, and it is popularly used in films and animated and video games, etc. So what I do is import the HTML file into Blender. Then I will go to edit mode and select what you call and find out what are the discontinuous regions that are there. So I'll select first all the continuous regions. I'll select, that is all the points which are joined together. I'll select this. Then in step three, I will invert and select the discontinuous ones. That is where the points are not joined. They are fragmented, etc. I'll do that one. Then I'll click on delete to enable the deletion of discontinuous points. I'll delete those discontinuous points here from here. Once I delete, then deleting the unwanted areas gives a finer finish to 3D CAD model, which helps in building a perfect 3D medical model. Now export and save it as .html file. This is what I done in Blender. Now I go to another software called Autodesk Mesh Mixer. So wherever that you are removed and discontinuous region, no, that you have to know fill up. So for that we use Autodesk Mesh Mixer software, which is again a free open source software. This is, I am telling now at present, whether it is free or not, we have to check. But this is, we have done around 1 year back. At that time, it is free of cost. So import the HTML file into Mesh Mixer software. Then you again do inspecting and repairing the errors in the HTML file. That means the gaps which are there due to removing the discontinuous, all those things should be filled up using this Autodesk Mesh Mixer. So once we have done this, then like this, you have to do 4 or 5 steps. As I said, in 3D printing, the CAD modeling consumes a lot of time. So you should put, you should work a lot. Your students or yourself should work a lot in developing this. Because if you do any error or any small, simple mistakes, the final physical model you may get wrong and the implant may be a failure. And finally, the patient will be a sufferer and all your hard work will go in vain. So you should be very careful in doing these steps, right? So once you do it, then once you finish that modeling part, then you have to send it to the software which is attached to the 3D printer. Like in our case, we use the Flash4 3D printer. We attach to that machine, we have FlashPrint software. So that you know, before you build the part, you should know how to orient the part, how to select the layer thickness, all of them you have to take. So you have to do all this, import the 3D CAD model, etc. And then in what way I have to orient, I have selected three types of orientation. Finally, I have selected plane X, rotate 270 degrees. It is consuming less time and also less material also, and also surface finish is also good. So once I selected this, then we started to build. So in that case, now you get all this green color, this is support structure that you get. These are the structures which are there to support overhangs in the 3D printed model that will be while printing. So which you can remove easily from the final object very easily. But the thing is, this plays very important role. If the support structures are more, what happens, it will affect the surface finish of your part. So if support structures are very less, then that also problem. Your where are the overhang parts are there, no, that part gets bent. So you should be very careful in selecting this. Once you have done this, then you go and go ahead with printing using this printer we have printed. See how the part is getting printed in the machine. So this is how the skull, everything comes here. So this is the final printed model. So this is the initial, before operation, we have taken the scanning and we have printed the 3D model. Yes. Now you got this one. Then what I had to do is, now after 3 months, after the operation, we have shown it to the doctor. Doctor understood how the fracture happened because of the accident, everything from the model. So he's now very clear how we have to perform operation. So he performed operation based on this. He has kept this model beside him while operation so that he will be able to easily locate how that fracture happened. Earlier, what happened with the CT, MRI scan, doctor has to simply think everything is in mind. And know while imagining, you may commit some mistakes and your assumption may be entirely different from what you are actually seeing on the patient during the operation time. But in this case, you are having a printed 3D physical model. Doctor is more confident, and as soon as you start operation, he'll be directly going to that point and selecting all those things. This is what the 3D printing makes to reduce the operation time. When you reduce the operation time, the patient suffering comes down, and the tension for the doctor also comes down. And when you reduce the operation time, automatically the accuracy also will increase. Because if there is more operation time is there, no, the doctor gets fatigued and he may not be able to concentrate much. So after using that, the doctor has performed operation. Now after 3 months, again we have taken the CT scan image of that same patient, done the same procedure, threshold value, everything, and then we have now printed not the unfractured side, because we don't require unfractured side. We want to see only how the fracture side, how the restoration happened to the fracture side. So we have taken on this left off of it, and we build the one same part and see how this after operation, you can see this, how you are able to put the mini plates, and they have put your mini plates, and see how the, now we are going to measure same landmark points. I'm going to select here and again measure this volume. So I am going to measure the volume of first contralateral side, that is unfractured side. Then I'll find out before operation on the fractured side how much is orbital volume I am going to estimate. Then after operation on the fractured side, I am going to again measure the orbital volume, and now I will be able to find the difference between them. That's what you have to do here. So you can see both of them we kept here, and these are the, as I said, landmark points we selected. We measured all of them with using a vernier, digital vernier caliper. The points are marked with the doctor. Even you can do better with a CMM, but with our available resource, we are done using the digital vernier calipers. So once we are done, then what we can do is, now before we concluded of a 3D printed model, we use the Maxlow Strata 1 software, which is a costly software, but we have taken 15 days trial version. We have taken same thing and we have imported the CT image. I get this image on the software itself. I am able to measure this contralateral side volume is 27.0861 is the orbital volume, and this side is the, on the fractured side before operation, this is the volume. Do you see how much the displacement happened? 29.77, so almost 2 cc as the displacement happened. This is how the vision impairment happens to the patient. Now after operation also, we have seen this got 27.3350, right? This is 27.086 original. After operation became 27.3. So it is, you are almost reaching to the original one. So right. So this is how we have done 3D printed models. We have done. So what is our final conclusion is, the unfractured orbital volume of unfractured orbit is 21. That is contralateral side is 21.04. Fractured orbit before operation is 20.9.04, and fractured orbit after operation is 21.69. So what is the thing you can conclude here is, you see this is the original, this is after operation, you are almost reaching to this 21.69, 21.04. So you reached up to 91.88% restoration happened. It's a good sign that your operation is okay, good. But still doctor can know, we have taken 10 case studies, we have done the same procedure, and now the doctor will understand what is the procedure he has to adopt to increase the accuracy of his operation. That's how we help doctor in planning his surgery and also in improving his operation methodology for especially the orbital volume zygomatic fractures. And we are done with the same software also. Software got shown that 90.67%. So definitely in a software, it's finally, it's a 2D screen only. It is a 2D screen. Selecting that points exactly, that landmark points on that, is very difficult to do it. But if you have a physical model, you can do it more accurately. That's why my CAD 3D printed model is giving 91.88% restoration. But using the virtual computer graphics software, you are getting 90.67%. So it means that 3D printed model can be used to evaluate the orbital volume due to midfacial fractures accurately than the your original CAD models, etc. Right. So this is my first case study. So you have any doubts, you can ask. I'll give 1 minute time. Anyone has questions, you can ask, please. Or you are unable to follow, you can ask a question, please. Any questions from the audience?
Sir, how to test the strength of a particular bone?
Hello?
How to test the strength of particular bone?
Strength of the particular bone? Strength of the bone, you can do like our, they have all medical, they have done already, this data is there in the medical journals. You have, they take cadaver skulls, they take, that means dead body skull, they'll take and test all of them. They do they know the properties of that one, no? They will make a specimens of that and test it. Cadaver skulls, dead body. Already this huge data is there with the medical journals. All of these people have that, a different portion of the bone, how much is the strength, that data is already with the medical journals everywhere, it is there. If you want to test it, then you have to go for natural bone, means you have to go for a cadaver skull and test it, bone properties. Have I answered your question?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Any more questions? Okay.
Sir,
I am going to the next case study.
Okay, sir. Yes, sir.
We will have question answers. Question answers at the end, sir. And you want to have question, right? Okay.
Yes, sir. We'll intake end, sir.
Definitely, but just only to test whether the audience are with me or not, because in online mode, no, I cannot see directly audience. I will be just seeing the screen. So case study
no
two is.
I'll continue. Right, sir. Thank you, sir.
We can, after this few more case studies, we can in between, just to make the audience not to feel sleep. That is my idea. Because some of you just switch on and go away. So next case study on development of 3D printed model for cranioplasty surgery. This is a very interesting operation we have done way back in 2013, around 7 years back. This is a very successful operation we've done. So what is cranioplasty? Is a defined as a neurosurgical project to cover an injured bone in the skull. So as I shown in the first slide itself, that particular skull, there is fracture at this point. So the challenge here is you have to develop an implant for this. At the same time, the implant that you put should not affect the aesthetic look of the patient. That means when he sees the patient, sees his face on the screen, on the mirror, it should appear like normal. But because I put an implant, it should not go shallow or it should not project. If it project, doctor, the patient may feel that, okay, operation is successful, but every time I see my face, it appears like everyone notices that operation is being done. So that should not happen. So challenge in cranioplasty surgery, the aesthetic sense also very restoring the appearance and psychological stability of the patient, very important in cranioplasty surgery. Let us see. For us, we got a case in 2013, a 16 years old male patient from Pune came, where there is a fracture on the left frontal parietal region. You got this one. So this where the fracture happened, the bone, you can see the entire bone was removed and the skin was just put on it and stitched it. Inside this, there is no hard bone, and inside this, you have the brain. So we have to develop an implant for it, where he approached the Care Banjara Hospital. Dr. Satish was there, and he thought we will use 3D printing for making that implant. Let us make the implant. So as such, we don't have at that time 3D printer which directly makes an implant. We said we can only make a pattern of the implant. Using the pattern of the implant, you can make a mold, and this is called indirect 3D printing tech, indirect 3D printing or rapid tool you call. So using this, you can make a mold. In that mold, you can pour a polymethyl methacrylate biocompatible material, and then you can get the final part out of it, right? So that's a final implant you can get. That's how we said. But when he approached, I asked him what is the regular procedure they used to adopt before 3D printing. If there is no 3D printing, how you do try to solve this case? He said they used to make the patient to sit on in the operation theater, remove his entire hair, put an basket around his head, and take algae, plaster of Paris, and go on applying it on his head so that they get an impression of how the fracture happened from it. So here the question here is, it all depends on the skill set of the doctor. He is a very senior, experienced doctor. He can have his own skill because based on the experience, he can get an impression. Or if it is a very young doctor, very difficult for him. And what is the problem with such type of implants is, the accuracy with which you can get the impression is not correct. And also, because human bone is not same throughout, the thickness will vary. So that you cannot get here in with the help of this. So these are because of these problems during surgery time, they face a lot of difficulty to adjusting that implant and fixing it. So this is where very inaccurate, etc. And sometimes if that the implant they made using this method is not correct, so it may lead to next secondary stage infection, and finally it may lead to contamination, possible rejection of the process later. So this what a lot of times this type of methods, they result in failures. That means the again patient will come back with some complaint and you'll remove and use this one. So yes, this is a very interesting challenge. It's a part of, as I said earlier, work is also I give to my MTech students. We do, all my MTech students will do work with hospitals around, and these are live case studies. Will they are, he will get degree only if he completes all this case, right? So we have taken this CT scan image of this one, of this person from the doctor. Then, as I explained earlier, putting threshold value, using a mimic software, all those things we have taken, and then segmentation, everything we have done, and we have developed the 3D CAD model of this object, of this human skull. Once you develop the 3D CAD model of this one, then what we have shown to doctor how the fracture happened. See how the fracture happened, we have shown to doctor. So doctor said, so please go ahead, sir, and print this skull, entire skull. What is his idea is, once the skull gets printed, he will put algae on, in place of human person head, he will put algae on it and get the impression. We said, it costs very much, only the skull, and it is costing 50 to 6,000, and you cannot directly put into the patient head this one. So we told doctor, if you require, what you exactly required, we asked him. He said, we require only this portion. This is the way I want to make the implant. Then we replied, definitely we are going to make only this portion. And then what you have done is, we have taken this symmetrically, we have mirrored this area to this one, and we got this image, this portion, and we have shown to doctor how this implant will appear virtually, right? And even we have superimposed that portion and shown how this looks once the operation is performed, right? So then we have went ahead and printed it using our SLS 3D printing machine in 2009, I think this work we have done. So then we produce the part here. This is the implant we got here, right? So this is the not implant. This is the pattern of the implant. We use the SLS technology for making this pattern of the implant. So this is made with. Then once we made the pattern, then you can make a mold out of it. And then in that mold, they pour polymethyl methacrylate biocompatible material, and finally they made the implant. This is how the implant was fixed to the patient during the operation time. You can see here the mini plates are fixed, joining the parent bone material and this what you call this implant. And there is some gap between the bone and this. You should give a gap of 1 to 2 mm because the person will grow. He's a 16 years now. He may grow up to 22 to 23 years. This how much clearance you have to keep is given by the doctor. He will be telling you how much once you model everything before you print. And sometimes they will do filing. They require they do it, the filing the ends, and this how they fixed it. And I say there are a lot of interesting problems in this case also. As a mechanical engineer, it's like a butt joint joining two plates against each other and putting a what you call, you're putting a mini plate, this is a titan, a mini plate. You can estimate now how much is the stress to which this screw is subjected, or if there is an impact again on this implant, how much load it can withstand. All these studies you can do. So I am using my domain finite element analysis knowledge for my biomedical application. This is what innovation is required from your side. So what we concluded from this is, we reduced the operation time by 22%, and the patient was very happy, and the accuracy is very good. And what we got here is, the doctor is also very happy because the operation time get reduced. No, his tension gets reduced, and it will reduce in loss of post-operative pains, inflammation, blood loss, everything. So patient is now happy with this work, and we got a certificate in 2013. Until now, there is no problem for the patient, is very happily living. Such type of things we have done several cases recently also in, I think 1 month back, I have done with Zygoma with Yashoda again. So like these such type of cases we have done using crop edit mask, etc. Again, all our AutoCAD, all our CAD commands we use, sketching the profile we make, then mirror the surface. Then we have taken intersection of skull, mirrored skull, and etc. Then we use a spline curve like you do in CAD now, you model this. And then finally, this is how it appears. And this is how the process appears. And these are dimensions we get from here. And then we produce in our FDM, small FDM 3D printer, this one. So using this, they made a mold and they use polymethyl methacrylate to produce the part. So this is the second case study. Third case study, how I apply 3D printing, or I am using different terms, like don't get confused, 3D printing, IT manufacturing, or freeform fabrication, or all of them are the same term. Only thing is IT manufacturing is the technically correct term used by ASTM, but 3D printing is the most popular commercial term used everywhere. So they don't get confused, right? So are some people call layered manufacturing, right? So all this. So let us see this case, how I use 3D printing for what you call it as facial asymmetry. See this particular girl, her face is her bottom mandible is now dislocated, that is, it has moved and it has deflected to certain extent. So what is the problem is she is not happy with that, that she won't rectify it. So she approached a doctor called Suresh from Sunshine Hospital, Secunderabad. And let us understand what is the facial asymmetry. You see, any human being, you will see left and right, both are not exactly similar. If you superimpose left to left, you look like this. If you superimpose right to right, you look like this. But actually, you are not looking like this. You are looking like this only. But for us, most of the people, the amount of asymmetry is not noticeable. So you will not be able to notice it. So we don't bother about it at all. But for that case, for that girl, it is noticeable. So you will not feel happy. You have to solve it. So it's like Albert Einstein. You see his original face, but when you superimpose left to left, it will look like this. Right to right, it will look like this. But actually, it's like this. This what is the what you call facial asymmetry. So we asked again, doctor, how they used to perform this operation before 3D printing. They used to use a method called cephalogram. What is cephalogram? They take X-ray of the region where they want to do this operation. They take in different views like front view, top view, side view. As I said, no coronal, sagittal, etc. They take all of them. And as I said earlier also, in human body, there are landmark points at every portion. So doctor will put a trace paper on this and they'll select and they'll mark. They put a trace paper on the X-ray and he will mark the landmark points on it. And then he will measure the distance between the landmark points. So once he measures the distance, no, he will know how much is the deviation. So for this, actually, one image is not enough. You have to take the front view, top view, side, like lateral cephalogram, posterior antagonist, everything you have to take. And what happened with this is, he is taking all 2D landmark points and then he is correlating them and assuming this how in 3D, this is how it appears, this is how it comes. So based on his assumption, he goes with the operation. So once he operates, no, once he opens, no, so see, you find that 3D location of that point is different from what you assumed in 2D. That's the difficulty you get here. So then we ask doctor to give CT scan image, then we have taken, modeled it, and we produce this, you know, this portion of that one. And then we are shown to the doctor how much is the deviation that he has to make before the operation is performed. You can see this how this mandible got affected to this, and this is this side. So you have to shift accordingly during the operation based on this measurement. Before the operation only, we have allowed doctor to plan his surgery completely. Once he planned his surgery, thought about how much he has to display this more accurate, immediately we'll open and perform the operation, reduce the time. This is the what transformation we brought to her. And the important point I want to tell is the joy that she got after this operation. She was very dull and she was very, you know, having a lot of stress, etc. before this operation, how she was looking. But now after operation, we have given a separate, different life altogether to us. So this is what I say. IT manufacturing 3D printing will help in working with different people, doctors like them, and saving so many lives, right? This is the joy you get. This is the your project work. Once you do, you know, this is the end of, this is the result, or what you call, instead of making some theoretical calculation and putting this validating, I am doing a practical thing. I'm showing the proof and saving the life of so many people. This is what the you should also do. You should also start working in different areas, right? So same way we are done for the, this happened in January 2019, and the doctor, we are able to reduce the operation time from 6 hours to 3 hours, 18 minutes like that. So almost 50% reduce the time, and the, see the accuracy with which our face changed, and also you can also see the doctor was so happy, his operation time got reduced from 6 hours to 3 hours. So his stress also get reduced. Patient is also very happy. All those things happened. Same, once we done that successfully, has given another one called facial reconstruction. See this particular person, he got the left side, you got this, from our side it is called right, but from his side is left. There's a swelling over this. This is a cancerous tumor. He may be using Gutkha, Pan, etc. He might have eaten, so that got affected. And what happened, because of this cancerous tumor, it has eaten away this mandible, lower, this called mandible, lower portion of jaw is called mandible. So doctor has to remove this tumor, then he has to remove the, on the eaten bone, he has to put a titanium plate to support, and then he has to fix it. That is the challenge for him. So this is how, this is my region of interest. I have selected, this is my region of interest. He's a 23-year-old patient, came with sunshine in 3 months. Swelling gradually over 6 months, and there is no facial weakness, but biopsy confirms an ameloblastoma, a rare benignant cancerous tumor of odontogenic epithelium, odontogenic epithelium, and it is called ameloblastoma. This is called, it is called osteolytic lesion with both cortical plates perforation. That means your mandible plates are eaten away. So we are taken again. You see, when we model, you can see this how that bone has eaten away. And then we have, what we have done is now the challenge for is now the doctor has to put a what you call an implant, the blade, the plate, yes, titanium plate is to put here. So what we have done, we have, this is the normal side of that portion. So we have mirrored this to this side, assuming that this is, there is no cancer, etc. And then we developed the mandible. Once you develop the mandible, then the doctor has taken the plate and bent it on the model mandible. This is how we have made the model mandible, and these are the plates you have here. So he has put the plates on this, and titanium plate he has put, and just simply he has a bend before the operation is performed at all. Completely, this is done before operation. Planning is done before operation. Then during the operation, simply has taken and fixed that one. So it's more accurate. This is a tumor that was removed. And finally, this is the transformation we brought to this patient. So it is also reduced by around 60% the operation time, and it is successful. The patient is very happy, and this is how 3D printing helped in solving facial asymmetry applications. Right. Let us see how 3D printing can be used for fabricating a surgical guide to assist in endodontic treatment. So how you can use 3D printing in endodontic treatment. So this is how you can see. It's simply, I just want to go because we are lying in time. No, this is nothing but a root canal treatment. So once you want to clean the root canal treatment, you have to drill a hole, and the doctor will use a drill bit for drilling the hole. So when you want to send this drill bit, you should send correctly. Otherwise, what happens, it will affect the normal portion of that one, so which is not affected. So it will create problem further. So we have made what you call a stent or a jig type thing. So it will help the drill bit to go directly through this exact position, right? So this is what we produce using SLM technology. We produce this one. So using selective laser melting, we produce metal one. We produce this implant, and we produce, so that we can fix it on the joint, see how during the operation how it happens. And they could see how after putting that and cleaning this, how this entire dirt, everything was removed and cleaned root canal, it is there now, right? So we reduce the operation time again by 50%, seven method, proposed method. And what you got is that these are the deformation we got here. Finally, we conclude that this using this metal SLM, use cobalt chrome, we are able to make it with 600 rupees only, and this helped doctor in performing the operation more accurately for this case, right? So similarly, as I said, I am going to talk about how lumbar spine can be treated here. Lumbar spine is nothing but another important portion of the human body. So this just I'll show the video instead of explaining all this theory. I'll just show a video so that you will understand how this lumbar spine can be treated.
Hello. Hello, sir.
Hello, sir.
Sir,
hello,
sir.
sir.
Yeah.
Please tell.
Sir, completed, sir.
No, please tell. Not completed, sir. Just
sir,
about to
shall
complete.
I ask any? Okay.
Not completed, sir. Just about
yes,
to
sir.
complete,
Yeah.
sir. I'll tell you. I'll tell you, sir. 1 minute.
Right.
Atlantic Spine Center offers endoscopic lumbar discectomy.
Are you able to see the video, sir?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. We can see, sir.
Yes, sir. Audible, visible, sir.
Yes, sir.
The spinal column or backbone is one of the most important parts of your body. It provides the main support, allowing you to stand upright, bend, and twist. Three individual bones interlock with each other to form the spinal column. The vertebrae are numbered and divided into regions. C1 through C7, cervical vertebrae, form your neck, support your head and neck, and allow you to nod and shake your head. T1 through T12, thoracic, that's the 12 vertebrae that are joined by ribs to form your rib cage. L1 through L5, lumbar. Your 5 sturdy lumbar vertebrae carry most of the weight of your upper body and provide a stable center of gravity when you move. 5 vertebrae of the sacrum and 4 of the coccyx are fused. It makes up the back wall of your pelvis. Between each of the movable vertebrae is located the intervertebral disc. Intervertebral discs consist of a thick outer layer with a crisscrossing fibrous structure, annulus, that surrounds the soft, gel-like center, the nucleus. Discs function like shock-absorbing springs. The annulus pulls the vertebral bodies together against the elastic resistance of the gel-filled nucleus. When you bend, the nucleus acts like a ball bearing, allowing the vertebral bodies to roll over the incompressible gel. Each disc works in concert with two facet joints, forming a spinal motion segment. The biomechanical function of each pair of facet joints is to guide and limit the movement of the spinal motion segment. The surfaces of the joint are coated with cartilage that helps each joint move smoothly. Directly behind the discs, the ring-like vertebral bodies create a vertical tunnel called the spinal canal or neural canal. The spinal cord and spinal nerves pass through the spinal canal, which protects them from injury. The spinal cord is the major column of nerve tissue that is connected to the brain and serves as an information superhighway between the brain and the body. The nerves in your spinal cord branch off to form pairs of nerve roots that travel through the small openings between your vertebrae, intervertebral foramen. This is the condition of a normal lumbar intervertebral disc. As a disc degenerates and breaks down, the inner core can leak out through the outer portion of the disc. This condition is known as a disc herniation, which
so you can see because of the degeneration of the age problem, or due to some kind of injury, this will get broken, and the gel which is there comes out and tries to press this nerve. Now this part, this goes to different parts of the human body, and this will stop blood circulation. Once it stops blood circulation, you get pain at that portion. So now in endoscopic surgery, what doctors will do, this is the latest surgery, they put a needle and remove this gel, right? You can
which
see
it. Which puts direct pressure on the nerve. Lumbar herniated disc symptoms include low back pain, legs and buttock pain, leg numbness, and tingling. Endoscopic lumbar discectomy is a minimally invasive procedure for treating lumbar herniated disc. First, a thin guide wire is placed under X-ray control down to the involved level of the spine. A tapered dilator is inserted over the guide wire. A small tube is inserted over the dilator to create a portal to the herniated disc. The endoscope is placed through the tube and the discectomy is performed. Using special instruments, your surgeon can now microsurgically remove the herniation, thereby relieving nerve root compression. The incision is closed with a stitch or two, and the procedure is complete.
So here the challenge here is, when they send the needle from here, no, there is a kidney and other parts of the human body. If there is a slight mistake of the surgeon, it affects the normal parts of the human body. So what our idea is, now you won't think about doctors before they perform the operation, if they can mock this, you can simulate this type of simulation. So what is the thing here is, it's a entire muscle, no, it's a soft one. So they are penetrating the needle through the soft one, exactly reaching the point. So we will inside, we will develop a model of that, we'll put in a box, and the doctor will now practice on this model of this lumbar disc operation. Then once you get exact idea, then you will do actually simulated on the you will actually perform the operation on the human being. That's the idea here of this work. So this is how we have done this one. And
strategies of endoscopic lumbar discectomy include the following: minimally invasive, short recovery, high success rates, minimal to no blood loss, preservation of spinal mobility, small incision and minimal scar tissue for.
And this is how you can use this technology for making this. So I'm going to wind up with another 10 minutes, sir. Sir, is there any constraint? Can I continue for another 5-10 minutes? Okay. Hello?
Can continue, sir. You can continue. No constraints, sir.
Okay, right.
Sir,
you can continue. Okay, right, sir. And this is what we have done. We have produced the different parts of this spinal cord, etc., and every different materials. We made the model out of it. Now we are still in the completion of that phase. That is, we are doing what you call a radiolucent material we require. We are in that process of developing radio so that it will appear for doctor when he penetrates the human body also. No, you will see on the screen whether the needle is going correct. Here also we have to make the model such that the material is radiolucent, so which will allow X-rays to penetrate, etc. That's all. Now the last thing I want to tell is, what is the future of 3D printing in biomedical, especially is this curve is called Gartner's curve. This is called hype cycle curve. This is from 2017. Initially, when anything new comes, now there is a lot of hype. There is a lot of hype that this happened, this can solve, this technology can solve this one, this technology can solve so many things. But finally, after some time, you start realizing this is called peak of inflated expectation. After some time, you think that, okay, these are the limitations for this technology. Yes, 3D printing has also got its own limitations. So you slowly start learning the limitations. So your expectations will slowly come down. But after some time, what happens here is, you start slowly learning how to overcome that limitations. Like, you know, in our pandemic period during the March or April, we are all very much worried. Oh, how to go? We cannot go outside. Everything collapses if we go out. Something happens to us. So a lot of speculation, everything. But slowly, once we started learning how to deal with the corona or those things, we are now in this stage, and we are now slowly trying to overcome these problems. So similarly, in 3D printing also, the limitations are there. Now people are slowly overcome these limitations. Now it is slowly picking up again. It is now going towards the better consolidated curve you are getting now. So we are in this area now. We are peak has reached in 2017-18. Now it is, we are in this is, and now slowly it is picking up, and you are overcoming the limitations, and finally you will be reaching in a better stage. Application, you will get complete knowledge how you can use the technology, and then you start going up. This is the future of IT manufacturing. I thank my director, Professor Sri Ramakadesh, for the encouragement he has given in performing this research, and M. Kumar sir, Professor M. Kumar sir, Ramesh Babu for their support. I also thank my team of doctors who worked with him, like M. Satish, Yarno Maxwell, Facial Surgery Specialist, MDS Rajesh, Neurosurgeon Ashoda, Sundar Abhinandan Potturi, Dr. M. V. Reddy Gar also, etc. These are my students and the team of CPDDM who are part of this, because this type of work can happen only with combination of teamwork, etc. So any queries you can post. These are the email IDs. If you are interested, you can contact through email IDs. You can contact me through email ID. My mobile number is here. So with this, I conclude my lecture. You have any questions, you can stop. You can ask questions.
Yeah, participants, it's an opportunity to interact with sir. Some people ask, sir, around 3 people have put some message. Unnati Yadav, she is asking, can't we made bone plates with the help of a printer, sir?
Bone plates. 3D print bone plates, means she is asking some kind of metal plates. You guess you can make using SLM technology, or you can use DMLS also. You may use for making the metal plates. You can make bone, that hip joint or some other thing. Yeah. She Unnati may be asking.
Unnati Yadav, right? If you want to ask other questions, you can unmute yourself and speak with sir. You can raise the questions. Hello, are you there in meeting? Okay, sir.
Yes, sir. Gayatri,
yeah, please ask.
From where you are, Unnati Yadav? Please introduce from where you are speaking.
Sir, from Sagar, Madhya Pradesh.
Hello.
Sir, from Sagar, Madhya Pradesh.
Oh, Madhya, please go ahead. Hello, please go ahead.
Yeah, you can ask the question.
No, sir, I have already asked my Hello. Question, and thanks for the answer.
Okay, thank you. Right, next question.
Right, sir. Next question, sir. Gayatri Patil, she is asking, please give some names of the software. This is one question. Other one is, there was something, Rhinocessor and Mimic software tools are there. Can you please name it?
Yeah, software Mimics, Invasilas, 3D Doctor. And these softwares are available. Invasil is a free software. Mimics is a costly one. So Trimatics 3D Slicer is also there. You can use them. 3D Slicer is also a free software. You can use it.
Yes, Gayatri, if you want to speak with sir, you can ask the questions. Gayatri Patil. Patil. Yes, are you there in meeting?
Yes, I am here.
Yeah,
you can ask, interact with the sir.
Yes, sir.
Dear participant, while you are talking, just open your video also, so that it is looking individual faces here. It is a good platform.
Correct.
Because almost all states people are involved here.
Yeah.
So I request you just on the video also unmute your device and you talk. It is a free platform, and our Shivaram Krishna professor is very eminent in this particular field. Please go ahead, all participants. Okay, it is a matter.
Yeah, Gayatri Patil is there.
Gayatri, you okay. Go ahead, madam.
Sir,
she has already asked question, sir. She complete. She got answer. Okay.
Okay, sir. One more participant, Pratap Reddy. He asked about which material used for clamping screws, sir. I don't know what type of clamping is.
He is asking the mini plate that we use titanium.
Okay, sir. So I hope sir clarified Pratap Reddy. And further, if you want, right, you can interact. I'll give a 30 seconds time. Okay, sir, he's satisfied. And one more participant, Sneha Lata, raised hand and she did put any message. Snehalata, were you there in meeting? If you can have an opportunity to discuss with the sir. Snehalata. Yeah, so these are the questions, sir. Further, if you want to ask anybody, right, you unmute yourself and
Shivaram Krishna is talking, sir. Somebody has raised the hand, sir. Please give some time, sir. Venkat Narayan, sir. Okay.
That's what Snehalata. That's what Snehalata, sir. Snehalata raised the hand.
One more person also raised.
Snehalata, madam.
You see that raised the list. Hand raised list.
And, okay. I'll just
okay. If they are having anything, they can also send me a mail, sir. I have given my mail ID. They can send me to mail or they can contact me also. No issue. Shivaraj Kumar, I think he has raised hand.
I think Shivaraj Kumar, right.
You can ask anyone.
Sir, do you provide any industrial training about this automation?
What, madam? Please be clear. Unnati Yadav, please.
Sir, is there any industrial training which your college is going to provide?
We have Center for Product Design Development and IT Manufacturing, in which we will give internships, etc. You have to come and stay. That means you have to apply for the internships, and it will be 1 month to 3 months duration, and you can do your work, or if not you do work in your place, you can send the STL file. We can make the part which you require and produce, or you want to have hands-on experience on doing using the facilities, etc. You can come apply it and come to us. I have given the mail ID to you, director@cpdm.com. you can write. And thing is, because of the pandemic, no, still that physical, we are allowing very less people, but yes, you can write. We can think about, right?
Okay, thank you so much, sir.